Hello and welcome to my talk about reliable MET exploitation. My name is René van Gruber and I'm going to tell you something about exploit development and especially about how to bypass different mitigation techniques of MET in the next minutes. So let's have a look at the plan for today. First of all, I will give a very short introduction about my person and my company. After that, we come to the basics. I explain concepts like address-based atomization and data execution prevention in this chapter, and then I come to the Firefox vulnerability, which I will use to demonstrate all my bypass techniques during this presentation. After that, we come to the first MET-related chapter. It's about finding or locating MET delay in memory. This is very important because we build every bypass technique later on top of this MET delay file. I will show you the advanced code reuse technique in a whole chapter. It's a technique which is already public well known, but when we talk about exploiting different mitigation techniques of MET, it's a quite good technique, a quite useful technique. After that, we come to the different mitigation techniques of MET. I talk about the return of data programming protection, so there are 5 different protections. And then I come to the export address table access filtering protection and how we can bypass them. At the end, I give you some final thoughts. We also talk about other protections of MET, but from the technical perspective, it's quite easy to bypass the other ones. So I try to focus here on the interesting part. At the end, you also have time to ask me some questions. The introduction. As already mentioned, my name is René van Gruber. I'm working as security consultant at SecConsult. Since 2 years, and I'm also doing my bachelor thesis at the Technical University of Vienna. Hereby, I really want to thank my professor, Christian Platzer, because he gave me the possibility to write about such a great topic about exploitation. And during writing my bachelor thesis, I also come across MET, and then my company gave me time to make additional research. And yeah, now I'm here. My company is SecConsult. We have global leadership in information security services and consulting. Our team consists of over 50 security experts, so really persons who are doing active penetration testing, technical persons. We have offices all around the world, but our headquarters here in Vienna. I think you can just have a look at the slide or at our homepage after the talk. Now come to the basics. In my opinion, 15 years ago, exploitation was quite easy. There were no real memory protections. It was quite easy to find new vulnerabilities. So for example, to exploit a buffer overflow of MET string vulnerability, I would say it was possible to write such an exploit in about 5 minutes. Nowadays, we have many, many different protections which we must bypass. You see here on the image some of them. It's not a complete list, but the 2 biggest ones are here, data execution prevention, DAP, and address-based atomization, ESLR. The reason why they are so big here is because, in my opinion, they are the hardest part to bypass. So if each protection on its own is quite easy to bypass, but if both are there, it's quite hard. The idea of address-based atomization is that everything starts at a randomized address. For example, the stack is starting at a randomized address, and that means that the attacker-supplied data is stored at a randomized address. For example, if you start the application 2 times, everything is stored at another location. It's also important that not only the stack is randomized, also the start address of the heap should be randomized, and the start address of all code sections. It means the start address of all modules. In data execution prevention, the idea is that data on the stack should just be data stored. That means data should be read and writeable, but not executable. Typically, an attacker tries to store its own code on the stack, and then tries to execute it. But if the data is stored there as not executable, it's impossible to execute its own code. So the typical approach to bypass data execution prevention is to use return data programming. That means you are returning to already existing code. And if address-based atomization is also there, the address of this already existing code is randomized. That means that the attacker does not know where it can return. And that's why it's hard to bypass both protections together. The typical approach to bypass address-based atomization is to first somehow leak some information and then build a rock chain on top of it. You will see this in the Firefox exploit in the next slides. I will use this Firefox array reduce write vulnerability from 2011 to show all my bypass techniques because I can show you here the code because it's a little bit older vulnerability from 2011. And that means I can show you the code without risking that any attacker can abuse this one, this code. I also think the exploit is very cool because it works very reliable against all different operating systems, starting from Windows XP, Service Pack 0, until Windows 8.1. We can bypass address-based atomization and data execution prevention. We are not using any kind of heap spraying, so one method to bypass address space randomization is to use heap spraying. That means we are just storing our data in the complete memory space. But if you are doing heap spraying, the browser would freeze for some seconds when we are just doing the spraying. And the victim could notice this. In my case, the victim would know really nothing. He would go to my website, gets infected, and would see nothing. So the browser is also not crashing. But unfortunately, I don't have enough time today to talk about all details of this exploit. But you can have a look at this talk by VMBH Davis. He gives a great overview about this vulnerability. I will just give you a very quick overview about the vulnerability. Basically, the vulnerability exists in the array reduce write function. And this function can be used to call invoke a callback function on all elements of an array. So if you don't know the reduce function, it can be used to invoke the callback function on all elements, starting with the first, ending with the last. So for example, if the callback function is a print function, it would just print the first element, the second element, the third element, and so on, until it comes to the last element. Array reduce write on the other side would start with the last element and end with the first. And the problem here is that, so the last element is, has the index length minus one. And the problem here is that in JavaScript, you can set the length field to any value you like. For example, if you set it to C0000, the problem is that index is declared as an integer. That means index can hold also negative numbers. And if you set length to such a huge value, it would wrap down to negative value. That means the index is negative, and that means you can bypass the check if you are currently inside the array. So in effect, we can access elements outside the array. So let's say the last index is 10, and it would just check if the current index is smaller than 10. And because it's negative, it's always smaller, and that means you can just access elements outside the array. In this case, if you use C0000, it would become the negative value, in the negative index minus one. So it would just access the element in front of the array. And since we are just adding here relative offsets, ASLR is easily be bypassed because the base address is randomized, but we're just dealing here with relative offsets. That's why we can bypass address-based randomization here very easily. If we allocate this, an array in JavaScript, we would end up with this data structure here. So we have here some fields describing the array. And here in the slots array, we store the real elements. So let's say we store something at index 0, it would come here, this location. If you store something at index 1, it would come here, and so on. But you see here, it's built in the data structure. That means it just has a fixed size. Let's say we can store here 10 elements. And as soon as you try to access a higher index, we must relocate this slots array because there is not enough space there. Then if it got relocated, for example, it comes here, we have enough space, for example, to store 50 elements. And it would just copy all the first elements to this new location. And we have here a slots array pointer. And this pointer typically points to this location. But as soon as we relocate this array, it would just be updated to point now to the new slots array. And if you make precise memory allocations just before making this relocation, we can control the memory in front of this new slots array. In this case, we can control the blue marked memory here and set it to any values. And if you now use the length field of C00, it would just access this element here. Every entry consists of eight bytes, so of two D-words. The second D-word is interpreted as a data type. In this case, it's FFFF0005. The 05 says that it is a string. That means that the first D-word here is interpreted as a string pointer. We let again this string pointer point again into our own data. Here we can set the length field to any value which you like, and the address of the string can be set to any address which we want to leak. So we can now give it any address, and we can read the memory there because we get a string returned and we can read from the string. This is how we can read now from the program. You see here the code implementation of it. I think it's a little bit too small to read in the last line, but basically here is the data type, here's the length and the address which I want to leak. Zoom a little bit into it. You see here I'm setting the length field to this huge value, setting it here. Then I'm invoking here the reduce write function with leak function as callback. This is this function here. Then I'm getting here the current element. This current element is now under full control of mine because I just set it the data type to string and so on. Just checking here if the data type is really string. And if yes, I'm just setting here the variable, throwing an exception. This exception is called here to exit from the reduce write function. And then I just return the string here at this line. And then I can read from the string and do other stuff. Yeah, but the thing which we really want to get is code execution, and we can simply get this by changing the data type from a string to an object. So typically at the start of every object, you find a pointer to a virtual table. That means it's just pointing to any table. And inside this table, function pointers to virtual functions are stored. So if you go a little bit back here to this slide, if the current element here would be an object, we would invoke here the type of function of this current element. So that means it would just follow the object pointer inside this table at the relative offset of this type of function point for this type of function, and then call the function pointer here. And since we can control the pointer to the object, we have full control over the pointer to the virtual table. That means we can set that, that the type of function pointer is pointing to our own shellcode and execute it. In this case, I'm just using the set element pointer here. So it's the same attack again. I use the negative length C00. I have just changed here the data type to 07. That means the first table is interpreted as an object pointer. At the start of this object is the virtual table pointer stored. If we again let it point to our own data, if we add the relative offset inside this table, we come to the set element function, and this is just pointing to our own shellcode here. And the shellcode would be executed. In this case, I've just stored here a small knob sled in front of it, and after it, because I can easily replace it with a break instruction and break before or after the shellcode. And here you see the C3 opcode, which is the opcode for the return instruction. That means I'm just returning from the set element function, and Firefox is just continuing execution as would nothing had happened. But the problem with this attack here is that this attack just works against old systems like Windows XP Service Pack 0, because in this case, the shellcode, the blue marked array here, blue marked memory here, is stored on the heap. And the heap is because of data execution prevention not marked as executable. That means we would get a segmentation fault on new systems. So the next step would be to somehow bypass data execution prevention. The typical approach is to use a ROC chain. The problem is the ROC chain takes every time the next code to execute from the actual stack pointer. So if you have a look at the memory, the stack pointer, as the name implies, is pointing to the stack. And the problem is we have just full control over the red area here, which is on the heap. That means we have to somehow find a code gadget which shifts the stack pointer from the stack to the heap. And if you have a look at the Firefox module, you see here, inside the Firefox module is code like here. This is a jump instruction. It consists of 2 bytes. And then we have 2 pop instructions and a return. And the idea of a return data programming is that we just return to this instruction, but we don't have to return here to the start of this instruction. We can just return it to the middle of it and reinterpret it as a new instruction. So in this case, if I just jump 1 byte after the instruction, I can reinterpret it as a new instruction. In this case, it's a leaf instruction. And leaf is exactly doing what I need to do because it will move the content of the base pointer into the stack pointer. And I just know that the base pointer is now pointing to my own data. And I think I'm quite bad in time, so I'll just go very quickly about over this digression. The problem here is that we have many, many different code gadgets which can be used to make the same behavior. So for example, to move the base pointer inside the stack pointer, we can use one of these instructions here. And what we have to do is we just have to search if one of these instructions is somewhere inside this Firefox module. And in my case, none of these instructions were there, and I just had luck that the leaf instruction is there. But searching manually for these ROC gadgets based on the syntax is quite time consuming and wastes a lot of time. So what I was doing is I was emulating all the code gadgets using PyEmo, and then I just stored the behavior of the gadget together with the gadget, and then I make behavior-based searches. For example, I can just then say, instead of searching for the syntax of the instructions, I can just say, show me all gadgets which can be used to set EAX register to 0 and which does not modify any other register. And using this, the workload can really be reduced. For example, here's the output of one of such gadget. If you have a look at this gadget, you see here the behavior is that it can be used to move the content of EAX register inside the EBX register, or it can be used to set this register here to 0. Or another task, if we have to set one register to 0, we would never come up to the idea to search for such a gadget based on the syntax. But this tool identifies that It can be used to set ECX to zero. Yeah, and now come to the first real Emmet related chapter. Basically, if you start Emmet, you end up with this user interface. You see in the upper part the global system-wide protections like data execution prevention or address visualization. You see the running processes and which are protected by Emmet. And if you click on the apps button, you can make additional pair process configurations. In this case, I have enabled all mitigation techniques for Firefox. If I now start my old exploit, with all mitigation techniques enabled, you would see that Firefox would crash. And at the right bottom, you see that Emmet detected that an attack is ongoing. So just remember for the next slides that the stack pivot mitigation technique detected that an attack is ongoing. Before talking about different bypass techniques, we have to make some general considerations. So what we really want to do is we want to protect against real world attackers. So it makes no sense to protect against some very rare cases where it's possible to bypass Emmet in some very rare conditions. And I think we really have to think like real world attackers then. And the goals of real world attackers are that the exploit is working very reliable. So if I'm the attacker, I want that when 100 persons visit my website, I want that 100 persons are infected with my malware. So my exploit should work against all different kinds of operating systems, against all versions of Emmet, regardless of if Emmet is there or not. And another thing is I want that Emmet, that my bypass techniques should be easy to reuse. So for example, if I spend 2 weeks to write all my bypass techniques for Firefox vulnerability, and then let's say 1 month later I find other vulnerability in PDF reader, I want to just make copy and paste and don't want to spend 2 weeks again to write all bypass techniques. And this last requirement brings us to the idea that we can write all our bypass techniques on top of Emmet DLL. So Emmet works by injecting its own library, Emmet DLL, into all protected applications. And that means it's a great target to build everything on top of it, because if it's protected by Emmet, it's always there. That means it's, we can just make copy and paste and it's working again. Emmet works basically by then making hooks. So it says you're hooking critical functions, and then before executing this critical function, we can just execute our own code from Emmet DLL. We'll see later, in the later slides, how this is implemented. So the first step is that we find Emmet DLL in memory. Other researchers, for example, the researchers from offensive security, also found some ways how they can bypass Emmet. And in this case, it's a cool technique how they can just disable old protections. I will come to this later. There are three blog posts about it. The first is about 4.1, then 5.0, and 5.1. And their approach also assumed that they must find Emmet DLL first in memory. And what they were doing is they just assumed that the get module handle function is imported by one of the modules, and then they're just calling the get module handle function to find Emmet DLL in memory. I also tried to implement this for my Firefox vulnerability, but in my case, I built everything based on the mods.js DLL. But this DLL file was not importing the get module handle function. So I had to first come to another module and from there read this get module handle function. But the downside of this approach is that it's just not, in some cases, not possible to apply, because if there is no module importing this function, it's just not possible to make it. And it adds an additional dependency on top of it. So you see here a ROP chain. I think it's the first ROP chain. I will quickly go over it. So we just read it from the first line to the last line. You see here on the right side, here is the address. So here's the address. And at this address, these instructions here are stored. So in this case, it's a pop EAX, because the stack pointer is currently pointing to exactly this location. You just pop here the next value inside the EAX register, which is the input address table address of the exit function of the other module. With this line, I'm just resolving it. Then I'm popping the next value. That means I'm popping this value here inside this register here. This is the relative offset. This relative offset adds me additional dependency, which is bad. Then I'm just adding it to it. So now EAX is pointing to the input address table entry inside this mods GRT module. Again, I'm resolving it. And here is the push. I'm pushing it and immediately returning it. That means I'm just making a fake function return. That means I just call the function. Then here is the return address. This would do nothing. Here is the first argument to it. This argument is pointing to this location. And here I've just stored the string mnet. This is the null termination of it. So basically the function, the getModuleHandle function, would just return this EAX set to the image base of mnet. And then I'm just coming here. This would do nothing. Then I come to this location. Here I have two pops. So the first pop would just remove this one. Second pop remove this one. And I'm at the end, and the next stage would continue. I now come to my approach. As already mentioned, MX works by hooking critical functions. So some examples for critical functions are virtual alloc or virtual product, because they can be used to disable data execution prevention. Other examples are WinExec, because it can be used to execute any program, or load library, because it can be used to load an additional module from an attacker-supplied Windows share. And for example, what MX can do is it can check if the stack pointer is correct. So typically the stack pointer should point to the stack, as the name implies. But in our case, in the Firefox vulnerability, we just shifted it away to the heap because the heap was under our control. This is exactly how Emmet detected the my attack on the picture. And this is the stack pivot mitigation technique. Before talking about my method to find Emmet DLL in memory, we have to see how a function call to a critical function is invoked by Windows. So in this case, I'm invoking here the virtual product function. If I make a call to this function, you would end up in the kernel 32 module. You see here, this code is basically doing really nothing. So you have here the standard prologue, the first three instructions. Then we have here a pop EBB, which would just revert the standard prologue. And we would just jump to the next function implementation. So this is just forwarding execution. Then we come to another jump. And then we come here to the implementation of the virtual product function inside the kernel base module. You see here the violet part is just setting up the arguments in a way the function needs it. And then we make here another call to another function. This function call here goes to the anti-DLL module. So this here is the real implementation of the function. This is the part which must be protected by Emmet. The other parts are not so important, but this is the real important part. You see here, this is the system call number for the virtual product system call. It's moved into EAX register. And we have here two lines of code which make the call to the kernel. It would just evoke this function here and then make a sysenter to go into the kernel, and there is everything implemented. But if we go back to the first implementation of the function inside kernel 32, if you now protect the application with mnet, everything what mnet is doing, it just replaces the standard prologue here with this jump, with the hooking code to its own code. And then it's replacing a random number of bytes here with CC, which is a break instruction. The problem here is an attacker could just jump over the first 5 bytes or return to this location here and just execute forward here. And Emmet wants to defeat against this by just replacing a random number with CC instructions. But if you're following this jump to the Emmet code, you see here, just a little bit, what's my idea to find Emmet DLL? What I'm doing is I just resolve the critical function following the first jump. And then I come to this location and just going downwards here to this until I find the call instruction. And then I see here the argument to the call instruction is pointing to Emmet DLL. As soon as I've pointed to Emmet DLL, I can just go downward until I find the P header. And then I have extracted the image base of it. But this is exactly what I'm doing in the code. But you see here something other very interesting. Here the third push argument, this one here, is pointing to this code down here, which is exactly the old bytes which were replaced with the hooking code of Emmet. So you see here the standard prologue again, here's the code which reverts the standard prologue and so on. If you again follow the jump, you come here. This is again the kernel base implementation of it without Emmet. If you protect it with Emmet, the same thing happens again. It just replaces the first bytes with the hooking code and a random number of bytes with in three. If you're again following it, we can now come to the real implementation. This is the real part which must be protected by Emmet. Same thing again. It's again replaced with the jump. And if you now follow this jump, you see here something very interesting. Emmet just has copied out. Again, here the third push is pointing to the blue marked area. And Emmet has just copied out the code which makes the real system call. So I will come to this later on, but maybe you can just imagine that we can do something with this. We'll come to this in some slides. This is just my hook approach. As already mentioned, what I'm doing is I just read the first 5 bytes. If it's a standard prologue, I know that there is no emmet. And if there is a jump, I'd follow this jump until I find a pointer to emmet, then just go downwards until I find the p header, and then I have the image space of it. You see here, this is the ROP chain, which implements this. But in this case, I have hard-coded offsets for different emmet versions, which is very bad because currently don't really know which emmet version is there. So if you try to exploit local applications, you would have to write a better ROP chain, but this makes it very, very complex. Writing such a complex ROP chain is quite time-consuming. In the case of a browser exploit, we have something better, which I will introduce you in the next chapter. So when I was developing this exploit, I thought, how can we do it a little bit better? And then I come across the idea that every browser or PDF reader must have code to handle JavaScript strings. And the idea here is that we can just use a very short ROP chain to manipulate already existing data structures and then return to the JavaScript code and work with these manipulated data structures. I later featured out that some other researchers already found this way. For example, this was presented this year from Yang Yu at KenseQuest. And yes, I think you can just have a look at this great slides from him. So what can we do with this? One example is that I can just say that the string starts at my hook in code, and then I can implement the complete parsing inside JavaScript. That means I don't have to hardcode any relative offsets anymore because I can parse everything in JavaScript, which is quite easy compared to a ROP chain. Another example is here, the third example, which is quite cool. I can just say that the string is starting at the code section of any module. The length field is set to the length of the code section. And then I can just use search functions, like the index of function, to search dynamically for the offsets for the ROP gadget offsets. So for example, I can just tell me at which location I can find a pop return gadget or something like that. And that means I can just write the exploit one time, and if emmet would be updated, it's just working again without any modifications because I retrieve everything dynamically. So in this case, you see here the implementation of it. In this case, I'm just leaking here the bytes at the virtual alloc function. Then I'm just checking here if these bytes is the move instruction. This is the standard prologue. That means that there is no emmet. I can just run the normal exploit. If there is a E9, it's the jump instruction. That means that there is emmet. That means I just scan down until I find the call instruction. This is this one here. And I'm just looping here until I find it. And then I just say, yeah, if the opcode is this, it's a push instruction. It has a size of 3. If the opcode is this, it's, for example, a move instruction. It has a size of 5 and so on until I find the call instruction. And after I have retrieved the P header, I can just read the timestamp and checksum field. And based on these values, I can identify then the exact version of emmet. Yeah. So now come to the different ROP protections, so the return of data programming protections. If we try to bypass them, we have 3 different possibilities. So first of all, we can just say we can bypass each protection. So there are 5 different protections. We can bypass each protection separately. This is described in the bypassing emmet 4.1 paper by Charlie Mott. Another idea is from offensive security. They just say we are overwriting a global flag and just disable all protections. But this is not really working anymore in the newest version, but I come to this later. And a third approach was developed by myself during making here the research. Here's the idea that we can, instead of jumping to invoking the hooked functions, we can just make the direct system calls. But hard coding direct system calls numbers is very bad because then it just works against one specific operating system. And in this case, we have something better. I will come to this later. So I first talk about the different mitigation techniques and then come to the tricks which can be used to easily bypass everything. The first ROP protection is the load library protection. The problem with load library is that it can be used to load an additional module from a Windows share. So you can give it a UNC path, let it point to the attacker supplied share, and then you can load the additional module from the attacker. And of course, this is very bad. And what Emmet is doing, it just says it forbids this. But in my case, I didn't have to bypass this one because I'm not using such things. But you can have a look at this paper here by bypassing all of the things by Arun Portney for bypass. Another protection is the memprotect. The idea of MemProtect is that functions like virtual protect or virtual alloc cannot be used anymore to make the stack executable, because the stack should never ever be executable. The bypass is here very simple, just make another location executable, like the heap in this case. But this requires that we modify the ROP chain. So typically, we are lazy, we're just using any tools we are using a tool to generate the ROP chain. In this case, I used Mona, which is an immunity plugin to generate this ROP chain. But the problem here is it's using the pushAD instruction to invoke the function, the virtual alloc function. And this pushAD would also push the target arguments. And that means we have not control over the target arguments. So I've just rewritten this ROP chain by myself. I'm now using a push to make the function call. And then I have full control over our arguments and can just say that here the address is pointing to the heap now. I will come to this ROP chain on the next slides. I just talk about the other protections first. Another protection, as already mentioned, is stack pivot. It just says that the stack pointer must point to the stack and not to the heap. And of course, bypass is also very simple. We can just write a very short ROP chain first, which copies itself from the heap to the stack and then execute the critical function. You see it here. So the first instructions here just ensure that the EAX register is pointing to the stack. And then here in the while loop, with this instruction here, I'm just copying everything from the heap to the stack. And with the exchange instruction, I just shift the execution to the stack. So it would just copy the ROP chain from before to the stack. Another protection is the callup mitigation technique. This is a very interesting one. If we invoke a function, we have three different possibilities. So first of all, we can make a call to the function, or we can jump to the function, or we can make a fake function return. That means we are just pushing the address of the function, then returning. And during return of the programming, we are just doing here the third approach. And to defeat against this, we can just check if the return address is pointing here, so in front of the return address, if there's a call instruction. And this can easily be bypassed, but instead of directly returning to the target function, we can just return to a call of the function. So in this case here, the original idea was by Charty Mott, and he was using the following call virtual alloc gadget. So zoom in here. Instead of directly returning to the virtual alloc function, he was returning to this location here. And because now here's a call of the function, the bypass technique is easily being bypassed. But in this case, I see some weaknesses with this gadget. So first of all, you see on the side, based on the addresses, it's inside a Windows module. That means that it would just work against one specific operating system and not very reliable. And another problem is that we have here many, many memory references. And if one of these memory references is pointing to an invalid memory, it would just crash. And that means we just have to come here from this point until the return, because the return would just go to the next gadget. And the problem is that it could just crash here. So what I was doing is I was using here a gadget from MMDLL, so it works reliable against all different Windows versions. And I just have one memory reference here, but I can ensure that this is not crashing. And then I just take this jump and it's directly going to the return in this case. But again, we have a problem with this approach is if there is no code to such a critical function, what can we do? And the answer is we can use any code to any register. So in my case, this is my ROP chain, which I'm using. I have here the push EX, which makes the call. And with this, I'm just coming to this location here, which makes a call to AD. So I just have to ensure that AD is pointing to the target function. After that, I just have the compare, which cannot crash. Then I take here the jump to this location. And here, nothing can crash, and I come to this return. And yeah, it would continue then. Sorry. Go back. And here on the upper part, you just see I'm popping here the next value. So I'm popping the input address table entry for virtual alloc. With this line, I'm resolving it. And then I'm just ensure that I move it into the ED register. So I ensure that ED is pointing here to the virtual alloc function. I think this is something which should really be patched by Emmet, because there's no valid case that a call to a register invokes a critical function. And it would make exploitation very hard if this would be patched. Another protection is the sim exec flow protection. Here's the idea that you just make the same the same protection from the column mitigation technique on all return addresses on the stack. That means that it's just bypassed with the same technique as before. Just go very quickly over this. And now come to the simple tricks to bypass AMAT. This trick was developed by Offensive Security. Here's the idea, we can just overwrite a global flag, and if this flag is set to false, all mitigation techniques are just disabled. And this worked for AMAT 4.1. And what our recommendation was, so we sent it to the Microsoft team when AMAT 4.1 was the current version, that they stored this flag at the read-only location, because then it's just impossible to overwrite this flag. But the problem is, in AMAT 5.0, they tried to make it with encoded pointers, but this is quite easy to bypass. You can just have a look at the second blog post where it is described. But in AMAT 5.1, they now moved it to a read-only location. But the problem is, there's a second trick, which I'll explain on the next slide, and they didn't patch the second trick. So what the offensive security team is now doing is they just use the second trick to make again this location writable, and then they can just apply the same trick again. But as soon as the second trick is also, So this was the ROP chain to do this. I think I'll just go quickly over it because I'm quite bad in time. So the second trick which I developed was to make direct system calls, because AMAT is completely in user space. They cannot prevent against direct system calls. But if you hardcode system call numbers, it would just work against one specific operating system, which is very bad. But if you remember the code from the start, you would see that if you protect the virtual protect function, AMAT is copying out the important part, the part which makes the code to the which makes the system call to its own code. And here's the problem. We can retrieve the base address here by just adding a relative offset to any critical function. Then we can just read here this pointer. This pointer is pointing to this, this code here. And we can directly jump to this code and make direct system calls. And this works reliably against all different kinds of operating systems. You see here the ROP chain for this is a little bit more complex. And yes. And I assumed that this would be fixed in the newest version of AMAT. So last week, AMAT 5.1 was released. I assumed that this would be fixed, but they didn't fix this, and that's why it's quite easy to bypass it again. I now come to another protection of it. 10 minutes, fine. Now talk about the expert address table access filtering protection. Here's the idea that shellcode typically has to pass a specific field. It's the address of functions field inside the PE header of these modules here. For example, to get the load library or get process address function addresses. And the idea of AMAT is that they just place a hardware breakpoint on top of this field. That means as soon as someone is trying to read this field, it will trigger an exception and AMAT code can make an additional check. So what AMAT is doing, it just checks if this code belongs to a loaded module. If yes, it's a valid access, and if not, it's, for example, from the heap, from shellcode, and that means execution should be terminated. And we have, again, here many, many different possibilities to bypass this mitigation technique. For example, you can just use return data programming and so on, but this all required, so the first three ideas require that we modify the shellcode, and typically we are very lazy. We want just to reuse the shellcode from Metasploit or something like that. So here we can, the most common approach is that we just remove the breakpoints before executing the shellcode. So we have again many different possibilities to remove the breakpoints before of it. I think I'll just go very quickly over this. The main approach was developed by PNDR Bania, but the problem with his approach was that he's using hard-coded system call numbers, and this is again very bad because it's not very reliable. And so we have here the first two approaches where to use the hard-coded system call numbers and then build everything on top of APIs. So the third and fourth and fifth approach was developed by myself, but they will not work in the next AMAT version, so don't just go very quickly over this. And yeah, I think the best approach currently is to just use the jump over the hook, so to make the direct system calls to remove the breakpoints first. And yeah, this works reliably against all service packs, all Windows versions, and AMAT versions. And now come to the final thoughts. As already discussed, we discussed the most powerful protections of MET, but MET consists of many, many more protections like attack surface reduction or certificate trust or CEOP. CEOP can very easily be bypassed as soon as we can bypass address-based atomization. If you want to see something more about heap spray protections, just have a look at my RocksCon slides. But bypassing heap spray mitigation is not very hard because you just have to use another address which is not covered by MET. So it's from the technical perspective, it's not very interesting. Mandatory ASLR and bottom-up randomization will just increase the functionality of address-based atomization. So yeah, it's not very hard to bypass this then. And EAF plus is something very interesting. This should prevent my current exploit, but it doesn't. I don't really know why. We had a discussion with Microsoft, and they told me that they had tried to fix this. But even if it would prevent my exploit in the current configuration, it would be quite easy to bypass this one here. So it's not also not very powerful. Yeah, this is a quick recap over everything. Just skip this here. Yeah, we from Second Sight would really advocate to work together with Microsoft on improving the resilience of the next MET releases. And we also have many, many different ideas to improve the effectiveness of MET. For example, if MET would patch the second trick, the second easy trick with the jump over all protections, it would be quite hard to bypass MET then, because then everything has to be bypassed separately, which means many, many effort for attackers. Implementing these simple tricks is quite easy and fast, but bypassing everything separately is quite hard. And even MET could also prevent against some other attacks, like checking if it's a call to a register and forbid this and so on. So there are many, many things which can be hardened by MET. Here you see a quick demo of it. You see everything here, the errors are all green. Firefox, a green error means that it's protected by MET. All protections here are enabled. If I go to the advanced options, you see here, I don't see it, that EAF plus is configured correctly. And if I'm now opening the old exploit without the bypasses, okay, it's fine. You see, it's crashing, so MET detected the attack. And if I now restart Firefox, so I refresh it, you see again, it's protected by MET. And if I'm now opening the new exploit, including the bypasses, you see it's just working and nothing's hanging or crashing or something like that. I can even execute it again and again. In this case, I'm just spawning the calculator to show that I get code execution. But I can also open a reverse Metapreter session or something like that. Here's a quick summary about my workload. The initial exploit took me about 3 to 5 days to write. It has about 400 lines of code. I think if I really tried to write it very fast, it would be possible to write this exploit in one day. But I was not really, I was doing it in my free time, so I was not very motivated to do it very fast. Writing the first bypass put me a very high effort. I can't really estimate the real effort, but the exploit code has about 5,000 lines of code, so it's really a huge number of code lines for an exploit. But the benefit of it was that when I had to bypass MET 5.0, it just took me about 5 minutes because I just had to add 4 lines of code because I wrote everything very configurable. So I can just say, I have implemented 10 methods to bypass this mitigation technique. I can just say, use this technique or use this technique and so on. So it was quite easy. So I just had to add here 2 lines of code, which, also 4 lines of code for 2 sample instructions because, so I just had to say, if it's the opcode this and this, the length is 8 or something like that. And last week I had to mitigate to migrate for it for MET 5.0. This took about 40 minutes and took about 10 lines of code. So I think in the next slide you just see the change of it. So this is the memory layout of MET 4.1. In this case you see here the P header is starting at this address and has a size of 1,000. And if you add this 1,000 to this address, we directly come here to the text section. See here is the text section. So there's no hole in between. And the same is for 5.0. It's again starting at this address. If you add here the 1,000 to it, we come to the text section. And the problem, what MET 5.1 is doing, they tried to prevent against my scan down approach. So it's starting here. If we add 1,000 to it, we would come to this address. And here you see there's a hole in between. So if I try to access memory in between of this, it would just segmentation fault. So what I was doing instead was searching for the start address of the text section. So was identifying this start address here. And as soon as I have this address, I can just subtract 20000 from it, and I directly come again to the P header. And this was the only change which I had to make the exploit again running for MET5.1. So you see here, just a quick screenshot, it's again working for the latest release of MET. Here are some contact information, and yeah, now at the end, thank you for your attention, and if you have any questions, yeah, you can ask now.
Thank you, René. Any questions?
Hi. Thanks for the presentation. Do you have any suggestions for companies, big or small, who are trying to implement EMET out there? What are the things they should consider while deploying EMET?
I think EMET is a great tool. So if you're an administrator or an end user, you should really use it, because in most cases, the exploit is mitigated. I think it depends on what the attacker wants to do. If it's an APT, so if he really wants to attack your company, and if he knows you're using EMET, it is possible that he's bypassing it, but it depends on the number of users who are using EMET. So let's say if 1,000 people are going to my website, and if only one person is using EMET, it would make no sense that I write an EMET exploit. Because, the difference of cost and the effort is not good enough. But yeah, I think if you're a company, you should really use it. But the problem is that some applications are just not working with it. So they're not really compatible. For example, if I'm using EMET with my Firefox, EMET is always crashing in all 3 or 4 days. Just crashing and saying that there's an attack ongoing, but I know that there's no attack. So this is the main problem of it. Any other questions? Yes? In front.
How hard is it to write an exploit that works for systems with and without EMET? Is that trivial? If you have an EMET exploit already working?
In my case, my exploit is working with EMET and without EMET, and it's working for EMET 3.5, 4.0, 4.1, and all EMET versions. I think with my hook approach, I just identify if EMET is there or not. If it's there, I just apply my bypass techniques. If it's not there, I just run the old exploit. And I think currently bypassing EMET is quite easy. For example, what offensive security is doing, it's just applying the second approach, so the jump over the hooks approach, to make the memory location again be writable, and then they're applying the disabling all hooks, all mitigation techniques approach, which is quite easy then. But as soon as EMET will patch the second approach, it would not be possible to make the section writable, and that means that they cannot apply the approach to disable all protections. And then you have to really bypass all protection separately, which means that it puts really high effort on the attacker. So this is the main idea. So the idea of EMET is to just raise the cost for an attacker to write a bypass technique. Because I think it's not really possible to write a 100-person bulletproof tool, which cannot be broken. Thanks. Any other questions?
I was just wondering if you're aware of any actual attacks in the wild that are actually using these techniques to bypass
them. I don't really heard about this. I just know that, for example, at the Pwn2Own competition, they are also having EMET bypasses, but in the wild, I didn't saw it before, so I don't really know. Maybe in some APT attacks, but yeah.
Question? So thank you very much.